Good morning, everyone, and welcome back to Union Church of Los Angeles Combined English Language Sunday Morning Worship Service. We are very happy to have you with us here in the sanctuary and on Zoom. Once again, if you are on Zoom, please mute your devices at this time. Thank you. And now, with your kind permission, Jin and I are going to open our service with a pop tune by Bill Withers entitled Lean On Me.
Thank you for that beautiful piece. Welcome to Union Church this morning. We want to remind you that whoever you are, wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. As we begin our worship this morning, I want to read a portion of scripture from the lectionary. Psalm chapter 24 says this: "The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it. For he has founded it on the seas and established it on the rivers. Who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? Those who have clean hands and a pure heart, who do not lift up their souls to what is false and do not swear deceitfully. They will receive blessings from the Lord and vindication from God for their salvation. Such is the company of those who seek him, the face of God of Jacob. Lift up your head, O ye gates. Be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of Glory? It's the Lord of Hosts. He is the King of Glory. Friends, this morning we want to invite you to worship with us. Whether it's your first time or you've been here since you were a child, you are in your Father's house and you're welcome here. I want to invite you to stand with me if you're able as we join our hearts for a word of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for your Spirit that is alive and moving wherever two or three are gathered. God, as we lift our hearts and as we prepare ourselves to give you the praise that is rightfully due your name, we ask that you would cleanse our hearts, cleanse our hands, that our worship would be pleasing, acceptable unto you. God, through our praises, we bring forth this King and this kingship and this kingdom into this world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Reuben. Please remain standing for our opening song as Jubilee leads us in singing 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, so let me be singing when the evening comes.
We sing, bless the Lord.
Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. We sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name.
You're rich in love.
Oh, you're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. We sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, just worship his holy name. We sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. will worship your holy name. I will worship your holy name.
Amen.
Thank you. Please remain standing for our next song, Let Praises Rise.
Let praises rise from the inside, from the inside of me. May you delight on the inside, just on the inside of me. Come fill my life, oh, from the inside, so from the inside of me. Set me on fire from the inside, oh, from the inside of me. 'Cause all I want, for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted high. All I want is for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted high. Just let praises rise, oh, from the inside. Yes, Lord, from the inside of me. May you delight on the inside. Yes, on the inside of me. Oh, come fill my life from the inside. Oh, from the inside of me. Set me on fire from the inside. Oh, from the inside of me. 'Cause all I want is for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted high. All I want is for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted high. All I want is for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted high. Oh, and fill my life till all they see is you, Lord. Glorify your name. Fill my life till all they see is you, Lord. Glorify your name. Fill my life. For you to be lifted high. All I want, yes, is for for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted high. Amen.
Take a hand, friend, praise Lord. Amen.
Amen. This morning, I'll read our community prayer from here. We're having a little bit of lighting issues, so it's a little bit easier to read from the floor. I'll be reading the part that says one, and we invite you to read the part that says all together. Today, this prayer is in solidarity with our Jewish siblings who are celebrating a new year during Rosh Hashanah. In our calendar, Western calendar, it is the year 2023. In the Jewish calendar, it is 5783 today. So we are going to be praying this prayer in solidarity with our Jewish siblings. Heavenly Father, may we recognize our solidarity with the stranger, outcast, downtrodden, abused, and deprived, that our common humanity weaves us together in one fabric of mutuality, one garment of destiny. May we pursue the biblical vision of peace, that we might live in harmony with each other and side by side, respecting differences, cherishing diversity, each living without fear of the other, each acknowledging the divinity in every human soul. May we struggle against institutional injustice, free those from oppression, act with purity of heart and mind, despising none, defrauding none, hating none, cherishing all, honoring every child of God, every creature of the earth. May all the peoples know peace this Rosh Hashanah. And may we nurture kindness and love everywhere. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Reuben. Please remain standing for our opening hymn, Cleanse Me.
Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior, know my heart, I pray. See if there be some wicked way in me. Cleanse me from every sin and set me free. I praise thee, Lord, for cleansing me from sin. Fulfill thy word and make me pure within. Fill me with fire where once I burned. Grant my desire to magnify thy name. Lord, take my life and make it wholly thine. Fill my poor heart with thy great love divine. Take all my sin, my passion, self, and pride. I now surrender, Lord, in me abide. O Holy Ghost, revival comes from thee. Send a revival, start the work in me. Thou wilt supply our need. For blessing now, O Lord, I humbly plead.
You may be seated. This time I'd like to invite Judah and Sojourner to join me. We're instituting a part of our worship in which we want to see our littlest worshipers. We don't have a ton of children in the church, so we want to have more opportunity for young people, for the families and the kids in our church to feel like they're an active part of our worship and our liturgy. So today, Judah and Sojourner are going to be lighting the candle without burning the church down, hopefully.
We light a light in the name of the Maker who lit the world and breathed the breath of life for us. We light a light in the name of the Son who saved the world and stretched out his hands to us. We light a light in the name of the Spirit who heals the world and fills our souls with yearning. And
together we say,
Light three lights in the name of the Trinity of love, God above us, God beneath us, God beside us, the beginning, the end, the everlasting one.
Amen. I want to invite you to stand to your feet if you're able. And we're going to be singing the song, This Little Light of Mine. This song, This Little Light of Mine, is kind of a synonymous with the children's song, but it's also been a big part of the civil rights movement, a big part of the resistance. And so we want to sing this song as we light these candles and remember the light of God in each and every one of us. So let's sing this together. One, two, three.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine. Let it shine.
Jesus gave it to me.
Jesus gave it to me. I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, Jesus gave it to me. I'm gonna let it shine. Jesus gave it to me. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine.
Everywhere I go.
Everywhere I go. I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Amen. You may remain standing as we prepare to pass the peace. This is an opportunity for us to greet one another, share the peace of Christ, and we do that by praying this prayer together. So join me as we say, Christ is our peace. Not an easy peace, not an insignificant peace, not a half-hearted peace, but may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with us now. The peace of the Lord be with you and also with you. Please get out of your seats and welcome somebody. Let them know it's good to see them in the house of the Lord. And we also want to say welcome to all those who are on Zoom joining with us. We hope that you are blessed. So good to hear the holy cacophony that happens whenever we pass the peace. It's just the most beautiful sound. People coming together, worshiping and passing the peace of Christ with one another. This morning, we're very blessed to have Pastor Ken Yabuki, who will be reading our scripture, and we are very grateful and very honored to have Pastor Randy Choi, who will be bringing us the word. So I want to invite Pastor Ken, if you would, lead us in the scripture reading this morning.
Morning. Scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 18, verses 21 through 35. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times? Jesus answered, I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who went to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. "Be patient with me," he begged, "and I will pay back everything." The servant's master took pity on him and canceled the debt and let him go. But when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed him and began to choke him. "Pay back what you owe me," he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, "Be patient with me and I'll pay it back." But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged, went out and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. "You wicked servant," he said, "I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you?" In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you, unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good afternoon, everybody. Good morning. Good morning, everybody. It's good to see y'all. My name is Randy. I'm one of the teaching pastors here. Today we're addressing it's a topic. I would argue this is the foundational concept of the gospel, right? Forgiveness. Basically through this passage today, the overarching message that God is conveying is forgive, right? Forgiveness is crucial. It is critical. It is actually, you know how the Bible talks about we are made in the image of God? God is about what? Forgiveness, right? So to be made in his image, to kind of seek after his heart, to in any way be a likeness of him, it's literally our mandate to forgive, right? But like many things in life, unfortunately, it is complicated, right? Many aspects of our relationship with family, friends, just people in our workplaces, people in society, it's usually, there's a lot of gray. You know, it's not as black and white. It's not that easy, or it's not that simple. And I want to kind of delve into that today, all right? So in the beginning passages, verses 21 to 22, Jesus is actually, you know, responds with a specific number, right? 77 times, right? So the 78th time, you don't have to forgive, all right? So he's using this as an example to what? He's trying to convey, right, to his guys, like, you know, forgiveness is crucial. It's critical to who I am. Hence, you guys, right? You guys mimic this concept, mimic this way of interacting with the people you encounter. And it's actually a very Jewish tradition, right? Jewish tradition was emphasize and highlight, don't hold grudges, right? Don't hold grudges, don't be resentful. And in our pursuit of, you know, I people coming here on a Sunday afternoon or Sunday morning, in our pursuit, right, of trying to be obedient to Jesus Christ, I want to kind of make these distinctions on not what forgiveness is, but what forgiveness is not, right? What forgiveness is not. And the title of today's sermon is True Forgiveness. And I borrow from a bunch of resources. You know, this is not original thought. But like I said, forgiveness could be kind of muddied water, right? It can be kind of confusing. So what forgiveness is not, the first distinction I want to make is what this one particular author, he wrote this book, The Good and Beautiful Community. He highlights that forgiveness is not what he calls abuse, right? Forgiveness as abuse. And forgiveness as abuse is like, you know, when we are, like, even if you read this story that Jesus uses to reaffirm the importance of forgiveness, it can add what? It can add a lot of pressure, right, to forgive. But if we're not careful, I think forgiveness as abuse can be problematic, right? And what do I mean by this? I mean, like, when in a two-person relationship, one is willing to forgive, but the other, what? Does not acknowledge it, right? But the Bible says what? The Bible says what? I gotta what? Forgive, right? I gotta forgive. So I am almost obligated, in my mind anyways, I have this perception, I'm obligated, I have to forgive this person. But this person is still acting what? Crazy, right? They're acting crazy, they're not changing, they really don't have any regret or remorse, they're kind of doing their own thing, right? But as a Christian, as someone trying to obey Christ and pursue holiness, I have this overwhelming, I read passages like this, I have this overwhelming pressure to what? I gotta extend forgiveness, right? Sometimes in these relationships, these two parts, it involves me, but it also involves another party. The other party's actions, behaviors, and mindset is a factor, right? And the nuance that this author provides, and I would agree with, is like, we are, as Christians, and Pastor Ruben has mentioned this before, we are not called, mandated to be what? Doormats, right? Like, I've shared multiple times, in this, through this pulpit and with, you know, the people at this church, like, one of the deepest pains in my life is, like, I grew up in a single-parent home. Like, my father was not present during my formative years, right? And it's still, you know, I'm in my 40s, man, and it still hurts. It left a gaping kind of void inside of me, right? And it's taken a lot of time to just kind of heal over the years, and it's still an ongoing process. But I remember I was in this gathering with these other pastors, and you know, we were trying to connect, right? Be intimate and vulnerable, right? And I kind of shared this situation I have with my father, right? Like, hey man, I'm a grown man, but you know, him not being present in the formative years of my life, it still kind of hurts, you know, and I feel this anger and resentment towards him still. And one of the pastors in that circle, he immediately, without even thinking, he just said, hey, you have to forgive, right? You have to forgive. It is the gospel, right? It is the gospel's. If you don't forgive your father, you are not living up to the gospel, right? And, you know, the old nature started creeping up inside of me. I was about to stand up, roll up my sleeves, right? Right? What'd you say, man? Right? Him and I, believe it or not, right now we're actually good friends. It was something, you know, it was a minor thing. We worked it out, right? Inappropriate, right? Like, that guy, you know, like, we're friends now, but he has no idea, right? Do you guys know, like, one parent saying, I will not participate in this family, right? I will leave, right? And me and my older brother, we were like demonic children, man. We were not, right? We were not easy to wrangle. Like, all the pain, all the, like, we were, the hardships and the difficulties a single parent has to experience, right? I understand what Jesus is saying. Trust me, I get it, right? But the process of forgiveness, sometimes it's not that simple, right? It's not that simple. It's not that immediate. It's not that quick, right? So in a loving, gracious way, I checked them. I said, hey, man, this is inappropriate, right? Like, this, you're kind of stepping out of your kind of realm here, right? And he understood, you know, he apologized and all that. But the point is, like, I get what the passage is saying, fully understand it, right? But at the same time, it takes two, right? It takes two, and that forgiveness as abuse is a real thing, right? Because if we feel this obligation, it's mandatory, if I don't forgive now, immediately, I am not a good Christian. It, something as holy and pure as forgiveness could be what? Weaponized, right? Against who? Us, It could actually be forgiveness as abuse. Is that making sense? Yeah? So be mindful of that. And another warning or caveat in regards, so forgiveness as abuse, another warning and caveat in terms of forgiveness and reconciliation is forgiveness ambush, right? And as I was reading some of the examples of this, it kind of made me laugh a little bit. But this is when, like, there's some conflict between two people, right? And I did wrong, right? I definitely did something wrong. And I feel this overwhelming need to be forgiven, right? But she did something wrong too. Yes, I'm pointing at you. She did something wrong too, right? She actually did three things wrong, right? But I did one thing wrong, right? I'm gonna get it later, right? I did something wrong, but she did three things wrong. I have not fully reconciled those three things she did wrong, right? But I feel so guilty about the one thing I did wrong. So I make this time, you know, to talk to her, and I'm like, hey, I want to ask you for forgiveness for this, but you know what? This is what you did, right? And this is what, you know, his name is James Bryant Smith. This is what the author of the book warns us to get. This is, again, this is one of those things where we feel this obligation, this almost duty to forgive now, immediately, right? From passages like today. But have we really fully reconciled what happened between the two people, right? And is that person in a place right now to really own the three things that they did wrong? I'm at a place right now where I could own the one thing that I did wrong, but obviously this person is not, right? So forgiveness is ambush. That's another way where this mandate to forgive can go sideways, right? So forgiveness as abuse and forgiveness as mandate, those are things to be mindful of. And contrary to forgiveness as abuse or forgiveness as ambush, true forgiveness, right? True forgiveness, according to Pastor James Bryant Smith, it is almost like an experience. It's a disposition, right? It's a walk with the Holy Spirit. It's super, super natural, super, super organic, right? It's a subtle yet significant nuance in the words and the actions in our relationship with God, right? So again, genuine reconciliation is not scheduled. It's not a scheduled, agenda-driven kind of thing. It's more like a natural, organic way of living. I want to talk a little bit about the story that Jesus uses to reinforce his point of how important forgiveness is, right? The story that Jesus uses is to drive his point home is there's a servant that owes this king 10,000 bags of gold. The king graciously forgives the servant of this enormous debt out of sheer mercy and compassion. A little later, this servant runs into somebody else that owes him basically a couple hundred, right? Merciless, right? He's violently attacks this other guy, right? And then he literally has him thrown in jail, right? Because he hasn't paid him back a couple hundred. Mind you, this guy's been forgiven of 10,000 bags of gold. The king finds out through other servants, right, who see the hypocrisy. The king finds out, and the king is indignant, and then has this original guy who was set free of the debt actually tortured, right? Tortured and sent to prison until he pays that 10,000 bags of gold in full. The last verse of this passage, verse 35, says, this is one of those tough passages in Scripture, right? It says, this is how my heavenly Father will treat you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart, right? If I don't forgive my brother and sister, then my heavenly Father is going to have me tortured and sent into prison? Oh my gosh, right? Hence, forgiveness as abuse and forgiveness as what? Ambush. In my opinion, is rampant. Rampant in church circles, right? Rampant amongst Christians, because this passage, if we don't understand this passage correctly, it paints a picture of God as what? Ruthless, right? Punitive. Zero grace. If you don't forgive now, I am going to get you.
And hence, you know, when we gather here and when we're reading scripture, it's so important to have scripture, in my assessment, is constantly counterbalancing, right? Counterbalancing itself. It says one thing, right? It highlights one thing. And then if you read a couple books later, it'll balance that point out. I'm not throwing this passage out. I'm not dismissing it. Has anyone here ever lived with resentment? Have you ever lived with resentment? I hear some people, yeah, right now. Have you ever lived with resentment? Have you ever lived with unforgiveness? Just hatred, right? Hurt. Have you? It is exhausting, right? It is exhausting. It's not sustainable. We're literally disconnected from our sense of self. We are not who God created us to be. I'm surviving, right? I'm not thriving. So Jesus has a point, a very valid point. We have to forgive, right? Sooner or later, even the anger and hate I have towards my father, it has to be healed, right? No question about it, right? But you know what this passage is kind of juxtaposed with? Other biblical books like Lamentations. We all love, who reads Lamentations? We all love Lamentations, right? I don't even read Lamentations, right? But Lamentations talks about that, right? Where God gives space for the wronged, right? He gives space for the oppressed. If you've been hurt, right? There is no quick to forgive in Lamentations. There, in certain Psalms, right? God gives so much space for the Psalms to be what? Angry, right? Angry, violated, like, I have been wronged. This is not right. God gives that space, right? And that flows in. That flows in. Even the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul has moments where he's like, man, Eric, what is this life that I'm living as a Christian? They're all picking on me, right? I can't take this no more, right? God allows for that space. So what I'm trying to say is, yes, this is an imperative lesson, forgiveness, right? But at the same time, if we read other aspects of the Bible, God is so, so patient and compassionate and walks with us in our hurt, right? In our grief, in our resentment, right? So understanding that counterbalance, right? I want to introduce, you know, if you guys don't know, I'm a counselor and, you know, big part of what I do, my 9-to-5, is like I try to understand like the human experience, right, and try to communicate that. And I think I came across this diagram. We're gonna go over this diagram, and then I'll cut you guys loose, all right? But this diagram is called the change triangle, and I think this is one of the dangers that these religious mandates or these religious obligations, like this helps kind of clarify some of the dangers in it, right, or some of the difficulties. The change triangle is just a tool developed by psychologist David Milan in the 70s, and it's for the sake of wellness, right, for the sake of wellness. It's like a tool that we use to kind of make sense of our emotional experiences and our emotional life to get us to a place of thriving, right, of wellness, of goodness, right? And so what happens here is, like, let's take, for example, this example of forgiveness. What happens here is there's something called core emotions, according to the change triangle. And core emotions are basically, like, we're born with these things. They're not good. They're not bad. Don't label them. They're just, like, it's a part of the human experience. These feelings, these emotions, right, they actually work on our behalf. They protect us. They kind of navigate, you know, they guide us in life. And these core emotions are sadness, fear, anger, joy, excitement, sexual excitement, and disgust, right? But what the change triangle suggests is environmental factors, right? External influences, corporate communities, including churches, kind of shape and mold how we interact with these core emotions, right? Like sadness. Like, have you ever seen someone you love cry? Like, I'm not talking about, but just like, ah. I made Jubilee laugh, yes. how does that make you feel? When some, like if, I love my wife to death, right? When Alex, if she's like really emotional, there's nothing I wouldn't do to stop it, right? Nothing, right? It's a human kind of instinct and reaction, like a protective thing where we're like, don't cry, right? Baby, don't cry, right? I'll cook you dinner, I'll do whatever, right? What the change triangle suggests is that as we kind of develop in our journey of life, we start coming to these conclusions. Sadness is what? Sadness makes my husband, sadness makes my mom even more sad. So you know what I'm going to do? I'm not going to what? Be sad anymore, right? Or I'm not going to visibly be sad anymore. So we're taught there's these emotions and we're taught like a value of these emotions. So sadness, I'm just generalizing, but sadness could be resulted as something that we have to hide, right? We can't expose, we can't really share, right? Because it'll make other people sad. I don't want it. So we kind of withdraw from that emotion, right? And when we feel sad, and we've been taught like sadness is this, then what happens is the inhibitory emotions, right? That's the top left or the top your right, right? We feel what? Guilty, right? Maybe ashamed, maybe anxious. So next time I feel sad, I've been taught that sadness ruins the party, right? So I don't want to feel sad. I'm not going to let people feel sad. I actually feel like a little what? Wuss, right? I feel weak because I feel sad. I actually feel ashamed that I'm sad. So I don't want to feel that. So these inhibitory emotions are created, right, as a protective thing against these core emotions, right? But what was the original theory? Core emotions are what? Vital. Core emotions are vital for our existence. To be human is to have emotions. So if I'm not feeling the sadness and the fullness of the sadness, I am not being navigated through this life, right? In an authentic way, right? Does that make sense? Anger, right? Anger has gotten me into so much trouble in my life, right? And I've been taught anger is you gotta muffle that, you gotta mute that. Actually, according to the change triangle, it says anger is actually a necessary emotion to navigate to our authentic self, right? But anger what? Anger in societal way, hey, in the church, what Bible passage do we use in the church? Don't go to sleep when you are angry, right? Make up. It's like, man, I ain't ready to make up. You guys get the point, right? If I've been wronged or violated in some way, oh my, of course I'm going to feel angry, right? So allowing space for a person to be angry. I know. If someone you love is super, super angry, it's very uncomfortable, right? It's very uncomfortable. Embrace. That's the invitation. Embrace these core emotions because the theory is that these core emotions are super, super smart, right? Have you ever heard of like emotional intelligence? These core emotions are critical, right? In navigating, and what's the bottom part? The bottom part, the end of the triangle is what? Our core self, right? When we let the anger arise, when we let the sadness arise, when we let the fear and the disgust and all these things arise unfiltered, unmodified, unchanged, right? When we ride that wave, so to speak, these emotions will gradually guide us to our core self, right? And in our core self, we experience, right, compassion, right? We experience confidence, right? We experience our healing, our authentic self, right? Post-conflict. Core emotions are brilliant, according to David Milan. They're brilliant. If we get out of their way, their innate programming tells us what to do with life adaptively. The core emotions, again, are sadness, fear, anger, joy, excitement, sexual excitement and disgust, allowing the core feelings to rise, feel them on the other side of the wave of the core emotion is, again, our core self, right? Calm, curious, connected, compassionate, confident, courageous, and clear. In closing, I borrow from Richard Foster, a quote from Richard Foster. Richard Foster says, "Whenever there is a form devoid of spiritual power, law will take over because law always carries with it a sense of security and manipulative power," right? What is he saying here, right? When we try to bypass our core emotions, like, you know, spiritual, have you heard of a phrase called like spiritual bypassing, right? That's what forgiveness ambush and forgiveness as an abuse is. I haven't really dealt with my sadness, my anger, none of that stuff. I haven't dealt with none of my core emotions, but this passage is telling me to forgive. I don't want to deal with all this. It's too dramatic. It's too chaotic. It's too unpredictable. You know what? Fine. I forgive, right? Whatever. I'll forgive you, man, right? Forgiveness as ambush, forgiveness as abuse, there's no transformative power, right? You know who did that a lot? The Pharisees, right? The Pharisees did what? They fasted 2 times a week. They prayed all the time, right? They talked about forgiveness all the time, but deep down inside, filled with guilt, right? Filled with shame, filled with anxiety, right? Because they were trying to what? Spiritually bypass the change triangle. And this is what Richard Foster says. When we do things out of obligation and duty, there is no transformative power. Obligatory religious mandates are powerless, in my opinion. However, forgiveness along with the flow of the change triangle, transformative, genuinely transformative. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. Where we could reflect on some of the nuances of forgiveness. It is a complicated matter. There's so many moving parts in some of our relationships with friends and families and coworkers. So we just really pray, Father, that you guide us according to your Spirit in how to mitigate, manage, and resolve these complicated relationships at times. And bring people, Lord God, wise people, into our counsel, that we can really work through some of these inhibitory core emotions and tap into our core self as much as possible. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Randy. Once again, during our interlude, please take a minute to reflect on Pastor Randy's message and think, is there someone that you would like to forgive from your heart?
Thank you, Jen, and thank you, Dan, and thank you, Pastor Randy, for that wonderful word. This morning, we want to continue our worship by receiving our gifts and bringing to God, out of gratitude, those things that God has placed in our possessions This morning we have a few ways for those who would like to participate in our offering. There's some pink envelopes in the pews in front of you, and we also have a few ways for folks to give online if that is easier for you. As we prepare our hearts to give, we want to encourage each and every one of you to remember that God is our provider. And just as this story talks about the very real reality of being in debt and having to pay back and to forgive, we thank God that we no longer live under the tyranny of scarcity, but out of God's abundance, we can freely give because God has given us and God has provided to always give to his children. So let us pray as we thank God and prepare our hearts to give. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the way in which you provide. God, we thank you for the abundance that you shower upon us, God. We don't have to hoard. We don't have to be envious or jealous, God. Lord, you allow us to live freely out of the abundance of your love and your provision. So, God, we give back because, Lord, you gave to us first. And we ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to stand on your feet if you are able to this morning as we sing this doxology in gratitude for all that God has given to us.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. I want to invite, if there's any announcements that I'm missing, please remind me for those of you who are aware of some of the things that are going on in the life of the church. Every week, we like to remind folks that we have some ways for folks to get involved. We have Bible study formats online, many of which are on Zoom. Saturday morning, we have a prayer time at 8 o'clock. If you want to connect with that prayer time, if you have specific needs that you want us to join with you in prayer, it's a really, really wonderful, sweet time. 8 o'clock is not too early. Just before the college football games get started, it's a good segue into the rest of your Saturday. Sunday mornings at 9 o'clock, Pastor Ken Yabuki is leading a Bible study as well on Zoom. If you would like to get deeper into the Word, just like Pastor Randy, Pastor Ken Yabuki is also a counselor, a trained therapist, and it's really beautiful to have all those different skill sets in conversation with our theology, with the way we follow Christ and understand the gospel. We also have Parkinson's support group on the third Saturday of every month. We want to really encourage you, if you haven't been a part of that, we have wonderful opportunity to connect with many of our neighbors who are experiencing Parkinson's and the loved ones that want to come and learn some tools on how to best support their loved ones. I don't have a start date entirely, but I'm sure in the fall, Anna, we're going to start back up with gardening at some point. So if you're if you haven't experienced our wonderful aquaponic towers, which is where we grow arugula, kale, bok choy, butter cabbage, butter lettuce. I knew it had something to do with butter. All I remember was butter. Amen. So we have this wonderful time of doing that. We have a composting corner. There's a lot of wonderful things. If you are interested in getting involved in the life of the church, please see myself. We have some ushers. We have folks after the service that are serving coffee and refreshments. Please, please, we hope that you understand that church, we don't just want you to come on Sunday. There's a life that we want to journey with one another. And as we think about journeying and life and all the things that go with growing, this morning we want to do something special. We want to pray for Jubilee Nuno as she prepares to transition into a new season of life. That photo up there is my daughter at probably age 10 or so, and myself. That's in a church in Echo Park, and I just wanted to say that, you know, it's a very beautiful thing to be able to see. To be able to serve God with your family. And it's been a blessing to see all these little ones grow. And the image that I have is I have a deep-seated fear of singing and playing music in public. But as it were, God has called my family and I to serve in congregations that are often on the margins and want to see God do great things in somewhat challenging spaces. And so what that's done is it's made my kids have to kind of like, all right, here's the real, just being very honest with them and say, listen, I need your help. And God has blessed my daughter with just the openness to, since she was a child, come and serve with the fullness of heart. And so this Thursday and Friday, we'll be moving her into UC Santa Cruz. And it'll be the first time that I have, I don't have my songbird next to me when we do Sunday services. So come on up, Jubi. We're going to pray for you. If anybody else would like to come and join around, come on, stand up here, Jubi. If anybody would like to come and just lay hands, this is a tradition we have in the church. And when we lay hands on people, just like we laid hands on our sister, Amy, before she went to Tanzania, it's a very, very visible way to let them know that even though they're not going to be with us in person, this is your Moai, this is your community, this is your space, this is your church. So as we pray for Jubilee, I want to read this passage of scripture that comes from the book of Joshua, chapter 1, verse 7, says this: be strong and be brave. Be careful to act in accordance with the law of my servant Moses that I've commanded you. Do not turn to the right or to the left, so that you may be successful wherever you go. Let the book of the law not depart from your mouth. You shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to act in accordance with all that is written in it. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall be successful. For hereby I command you, be strong and be brave, Jubilee. Do not be frightened. Do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Jubilee, we release you into this beautiful new season in life. Go flourish. Be brave. Have fun. It's in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. I want to invite Pastor Randy, if he would stay up here and give us this closing benediction as we go forth from this place.
Feels good. Feels good. I mean, I respect Pastor Ruben in many ways, and I think top of the list is his presence, man. His presence as a father, right? Like, it's so evident, his love for his children. And it just really warms your heart, man. Beautiful family. Receive the benediction. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Randy. Please remain standing for our closing song as Jubilee and the team lead you in our closing song, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. Lord, I lift your name. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. One more time. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Thank you. Thank you for joining us today. Have a great week, and we'll see you again next Sunday.